Good morning, church.
Good morning.
What a blessing it is to be back in the house of the Lord. I hope and trust that everyone's had a very blessed week. Always, we want to welcome our Facebook viewers and YouTube. We're so thankful that you've tuned in to us this morning. We pray that we can be a blessing to you. If you have your Bibles for our devotional reading, let's go to the New Testament, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. This is probably one of my very favorite scriptures here. When you find your place, if you're able, let's stand as we reference the reading of the Word of God. And I said, verse 18, let's back up to verse 16. 1 Thessalonians 5, let's look at verse 16 through 18. Paul says, rejoicing evermore. Pray without ceasing, in everything giving thanks, for this is the will of God concerning you. In everything giving thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Quench not the Spirit. But as we look at verse 18, he says, in everything giving thanks. You know, there's a lot of Christians, they go through life sometimes being frustrated because they never really find the will of God for their lives. Well, I can say this, that the will of God starts by being thankful. Being thankful for all things. And you notice Paul says, in everything. So he's concluding, or he's including, even in bad times, even in troubled times, being thankful. Well, why? Because as Christians, we know that God has a perfect plan for our life. We know that God is always with us, that God is always leading us. And even though that maybe sometimes God will permit us to go through trials of suffering or maybe even hardship, it really is for our good. Because I've noticed, and I bet you can say the same thing, that even in times of suffering, we've experienced more of God's grace and more of God than while we was on the mountaintop. Amen. So he says, in everything, giving thanks. Well, you know, I'm very thankful this morning. You know, and every time I go to the Lord in prayer, I've always got to start by thanking Jesus. Thanking Jesus for the day, thanking Jesus for salvation, thanking Jesus for the church, for all the blessings that he bestows upon us daily. You know, Jeremiah says the Lord's mercies is new every morning. As a child of God, how could we not be thankful, right? Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, God, again, as we come before you, with very thankful hearts, God, knowing, Father Lord, that you have a perfect plan for our life, and knowing, God, as the Bible pictures you as the good shepherd leading the sheep. Father God, I'm so grateful, Lord, that you have a perfect plan for our lives, God. And Lord, we want to be submissive. We want you to lead us, Father God. This morning, I'm so thankful, Lord, for my church family, God. I'm thankful for the love that they have shown to me and my wife and my family, God. Lord, we're just thankful, Lord, for the blessed hope that we have, God, that one of these days we're going to take a trip, Lord, and never look back, and we're going to dwell with you forevermore, God. Where you're going to wipe all tears from our eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sickness nor sorrow, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. God, Lord, I just pray this morning. I want to stand in the gap, make up the hedge, Lord, for my country, Lord. I love my country, God, but Lord, it's certain that we are living in very troublesome days, God. Every time we turn on the news, we're hearing about somebody being killed, somebody being raped. We hear about a lot of these violent protesters that's very destructive, that's very deadly. God, Lord, I just pray that you would just intervene, Lord. We need you. We need you at this very hour, God. And you're the only one that has the answers, God. And you're the only one that can fix the problems that we're facing, God. But Lord, we're facing so much spiritual problems, God. This goes beyond just the physical, Lord. It's very certain, God, as we study your word, that we have forsaken you, that we have turned back to our own ways, God. Lord, I was thinking about the word righteousness this morning and what it means. And God, the only time we ever hear about that is in church. Our country leaders never mention it. It's never mentioned outside these walls. But the Bible says, righteousness exalteth a nation, and a sin is reproached to any people. God, I humbly pray this morning that we could experience a heaven sent, a Holy Ghost revival in the hour that we're living in. That is the only thing that's going to fix our nation. If we choose to repent and turn back to you, God, I pray, Lord, that this would be our deepest desire, Lord, that we would repent in godly sorrow, Lord Jesus, and put you back in our heart and in our lives. God, I thank you, Lord, for this time that I can stand and preach and proclaim the gospel of Christ, Lord. I pray, God, again, that you'll intervene, Lord. I can do nothing without you, but we can do all things through you, God. All I desire to be is a mouthpiece, Lord. I thank you for the doors you've opened to us, God, that we may go forth and minister by the way of Facebook and YouTube. Maybe somebody is listening this morning, God. They don't know where they're going to spend eternity. They've never been set free from sin. They're a slave to sin this morning. I pray, God, that they would give their undivided attention, Lord, and that, Father God, they would think about and consider where they're going to spend eternity. It's either going to be heaven or hell. And Jesus, I'm so thankful, Lord, that when you went to the cross, Lord, and laid down your life, you died that all men might be saved. You left nobody out, and we're thankful for that, God. Lord, help us this morning as we worship you in spirit and truth. We pray, God, that it would be very pleasing to you, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I also want to thank my wife, Tina, and Tanya for coming down and decorating the church, fixing these beautiful flowers outside. I'm also thankful for Brother Randy, Sister Jackie, invited us down Friday night. They had steak fixed for us, potatoes, salad, then they topped it off with a blueberry cobbler. And I thought to myself, I want to stay on the good side of these people. Amen. And that's a man after my own heart right there. Fix me steak. A lot of these preachers, they like chicken, but give me steak over chicken any day of the week and I'll be happy. Amen. I sung this song last Sunday night. I want to try it again, so y'all pray for me. Stop by.
tell you what, as we play this worship song, let's all stand to our feet. Let us just lift our hands to the God of heaven, and let us just worship Him in spirit and truth this morning. Jesus is so good. Song is so true. I don't know about you guys, but I'm not going to give no place to fear. All right, I just noticed I ain't got my mic on, but I got the pulpit mic, so that's okay, right? If you have your places, if you have your Bibles, let's go to the Gospel of Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18. Did somebody else have a song this morning? All right. I'm going to make you all do a lot of standing this morning, looks like. Those that are able to stand, let's stand again. Matthew 18, I want to look at verse 21, and we're going to go down to verse 35. I'll give you just a moment to find your place there. The Bible says, "Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how shall my brother sin against me, and I forgive him, till seven times? Jesus said unto him, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven. Therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king which would take account of his servants. And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him which owed him 10,000 talents. But for as much as he had not to pay, his Lord commanded him to be sold, his wife and children, and all that he had, and payment to be made. And the servant therefore fell down and worshipped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay thee all. And then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion and loosed him and forgave him the debt. But that same servant went out and found one of his fellow servants, which owed him 100 pence. And he laid hands on him, and he took him by the throat, saying, Pay me that thou owest. And his fellow servant fell down at his feet and besought him, saying, Have patience with me, and I will pay thee all. And he would not, but went and cast him into prison till he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what was done, they were very sorry, and came and told unto their lord all that was done. And then his lord, after that he had called him, said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all thy debt because thou desirest me. Shouldest not thou also have had compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? His lord was wroth and delivered him to the tormentors till he should pay all that was due unto him. So likewise shall my heavenly Father do also to you, unto you, if he from your hearts forgive not every one his brother their trespasses." Thank you. You may be seated. So it seems as though Peter had some trouble with unforgiveness. And it could have been towards his brother Andrew, or it could have been towards some of the servants of Rome, the way they was mistreating Jewish people. We don't know exactly because the Bible doesn't go into detail. But Peter was well aware of the Jewish rabbis teaching their students that they would and must forgive up to three times, but then they could retaliate. So as Peter, knowing this, he thought, you know, the Lord is going to think much of me being willing to forgive more than three times. Surely this would impress the Lord if I should say, should I forgive until seven times? You know, that's kind of remarkable when we think about it, because most of us, we're not willing to forgive after the second time somebody does something to us. But now, as we think upon our subject this morning, the un-Christ-like servant, and as we address the issue of unforgiveness, Jesus didn't say that this would be a good ideal. This is absolutely required of our Lord's followers, as his disciples, as his children. You and I, we are absolutely required to forgive. So Jesus says to Peter, he says, Peter, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven. Well, if we do the math here, Jesus is saying, you forgive all the way up to 490 times. But was that what he was saying? Was Jesus saying, Peter, I want you to take a pencil and a notepad, and I want you to keep up with how many times this person will offend you, then after 490 times you can retaliate? Is that what he's saying? That's not what he's saying at all, is it? In so many words, through this parable, We're going to see that Jesus is teaching not only Peter, but all of the disciples, that you have an unlimited forgiveness. You and I today, friends, we are to have an unlimited forgiveness when we are done wrong. And you know, as we live, you're going to be done wrong. We've all been done wrong. I've been done wrong. But the most important thing is to release it, to forgive that person and move on. Well, Jesus is going to further illustrate this by giving a parable. Now, you know, I'm going to elaborate on this parable, and I'm sure there's somebody who's going to try to sit me right on Facebook. Hey, brother, this is just a parable. You know what? Jesus is giving this parable to drive home the principle of forgiveness. Okay? And you know what a parable was? I explained it once before. It was common in the Bible days for rabbis to speak in parables. It was a story. But what made our Lord's much different than that of the rabbis, his had a heavenly meaning and application to it. So a parable was like a story to illustrate a moral truth from right and wrong. It would draw their listeners' attention in rather than coming out and addressing it as most of the time we do today. So he gives this parable. Now, notice with me in verse 23, he says, "Therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king which would take account of his servants." Well, you know, the first thing that we notice as we read this parable, in verse 21 through 27, we see the king's forgiveness. Now, you notice with me that he called forth the people that owed him, and this one man that was called forth owed him 10,000 talents. Friends, that is an absolute tremendous amount of money. And without a doubt, this man was probably a high-ranking governor in the king's kingdom, if you please, which probably embezzled money over a period of years and all at once probably made some type of bad investment that lost everything. But he was brought forth before the king to pay all that he had owed, 10,000 talents. You know, somebody said, if this was estimated in our currency today, it would be well up in the billions of dollars. And yet, he has nothing to pay. And you know, it was common in the Bible days that if you owed somebody something and you couldn't pay, then all your substance was to be sold, even you and your family. And you was become the one that you owed money to, their servants, till the debt was to be paid. So this man, he falls down and he worships and he says, "Please have mercy on me, be patient with me, and I will pay you everything that I owe you." Well, the Bible says the king was moved with compassion. And what's so remarkable about this, the king completely forgives him of his debt. He owed a debt, friends. Listen, I want you to really get this. He owed a debt that it was absolutely impossible to pay. The matter of the fact is that he, along with his children, could have spent their whole lifetime working on this debt, and then just to come down to die, only begun to scratch the surface of this debt. That's how much they owed. Owed a debt that couldn't be paid, but because of this king's compassion, he says, "You're forgiven. The debt is forgiven." Yeah. Are you getting the picture this morning? Mm-hmm. Isn't this a beautiful picture of what Christ did for us? Yeah. We was born into sin. We was born in debt. We had a debt hanging over our heads that it was impossible for us to pay back. And yet the Son of God, Jesus Christ, goes to Calvary and he pays a debt that we could not pay, that we could be forgiven. Amen. What a king we have this morning. What a King we serve this morning. Knowing that my sins are forgiven. He took my sins. He took your sins upon Himself. And He died in our place that our debt could be forgiven. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. Glory to God. Peter says that Christ lived and left us an example that we should follow. When we think about the examples that Christ left us, they're numerous. But I think about the one example that He left us that was demonstrated on Calvary. In Luke 23, verse 34, when Jesus laid down His life upon the cross, when they started to drive those nails in His hands and His feet, He says, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And they parted His raiment and cast lots upon it. He pleaded for our forgiveness. What a wonderful example He left for you and I, that we too, we are to show the same grace, the same mercy, the same forgiveness as was shown to us. Amen, church. Amen. That is our obligation. That is our duty as a Christian. No matter what people does to us, no matter how bad they wound us and hurt us, we are to be Christ-like and to show forgiveness. Jesus said in Matthew 5:44, "But I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good for them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you." Amen. That's what sets us apart from the world. Each and every single one of us, at one time you was lost and undone. And if somebody done you wrong, you took retaliation out upon them, more than likely. But now, being the saints of God, we do things in a much different way. I don't set out to get even with somebody. When somebody does something wrong to me, I want to be Christ-like. It is my heart to forgive and to love people. But yet, at the same time, showing some wisdom in the matter. Well, you know, we see the King's forgiveness. But that is a wonderful picture of God on Christ's behalf, forgiving us. But then we go on to verse 28 through 30. We see the servant's forgetfulness. You know, how in the world can somebody experience so much grace, mercy, love, and yet just turn right around and not willing to show what was shown to him? How quickly are people to forget what God has done? He went out and he found somebody that owed him a very small amount of money, which could easily be paid back in a couple of months. And when that man fell down and said, "Please have mercy on me. Please be patient with me, and I will pay you all that I owe," he takes him and grabs him around the throat, probably slams him up against the wall, and says, "No, you pay me what you owe me now." Well, he threw him into the prison. Oh, God help us this morning. I wonder how Jesus sees us when He has shown much grace, much love, much mercy, much forgiveness. How does He view us when we're unwilling to forgive? And that is a serious thought right there. Did you know that God is expecting us to do to others as has been done to us? Jesus says in Mark 11:26, "But if he do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive you of your trespasses." Paul said in Ephesians 4:32, "Be ye kind one to another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake has forgiven us." This is our duty. This is our responsibility. And you know, the devil works hard to bring people into our life that is going to betray us, it's going to hurt us, because the devil is hoping that we'll get a grudge. Amen. The devil is hoping that he can get a foot in the door of our heart. He'll make sure he'll bring people into your life that's going to wound you, that's going to hurt you. I want to be Christ-like, and I know that you want to be Christ-like. And you know, this is one of the most important principles that Paul gave to the child of God, is to remind them that we are to walk in the Spirit, that we might not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Now, even though we're saved and been redeemed, if you find yourself walking in the flesh, you're going to find it very hard and difficult to forgive those that has wounded you, because you're taking on the characteristics of that old man I just sung about. You see? The devil is not my worst enemy. You know who my worst enemy is? You're looking at him. You know who your worst enemy is? I'm looking at you. It is an ongoing warfare against this flesh. I hate this flesh. This flesh causes us more problems, and yet we're so quick to pass the buck to the devil. Well, the devil maybe. The devil can't make you do nothing. The devil will tempt you. He will entice you, but you're the one that gives into it. You see? We are the one that gives into that. So if I'm walking in the flesh, I'm going to find it difficult to forgive those that has harmed me. But that's why Paul says no one can please God by walking in the flesh. We must learn to crucify the flesh daily, that we might live a life that's pleasing and acceptable unto the Lord. The servant forgetfulness. God help us not to forget what God has done for us. You know what I do, dear friends, and I want to compel you to do this if you don't already do it. I want you to keep the cross in mind and in view. When somebody hurts you, you be quickly to remind yourself, look what I did to Jesus. Look what you did to Jesus. We're all responsible of putting the Son of God upon the cross. We're all responsible for that. If he did not go to the cross, we would be without hope, and it would be a life most miserable. Look around us today, friends. I mean, listen, every time I turn on the news, it's gloom and doom. Communities burning down. People are being shot and killed. Again, no value upon life whatsoever. Not these little babies, not these little children. They could care less. I am so thankful that I got something greater and better to look forward to. That is the kingdom to come. We want to be well-pleasing unto the Lord. But then we also notice in verse 31, the fellow servant's faithfulness. You see, I say this a lot, but as Christians, we are on stage constantly. The spotlight is upon us constantly. The world is looking upon us, especially when somebody harms you. They're looking at us, seeing how we're going to deal with the matter, right? You know, you'll have the worldly people that say, boy, you know what, if I was you, well, that's a problem. You're not me. Amen. We handle things and we do things much different than we used to, because we are not of this world. But they saw what had happened. They were troubled. They were discouraged. And they went and they told the Lord what had happened. You see, we have such a wonderful and a positive testimony if we would just do things and handle things godly in the way God would have us to. When we learn and when we're able to forgive and just let it go and release it, we have a good, wonderful, positive testimony. Because people is like, they're looking at you like, did my eyes deceive me? Did they say, I forgive you? You know what, friends? Different times we can be watching the news And we can see remarkable things of maybe people in the courtroom that says, you know what, I forgive you. I remember watching this story about this guy that was drunk, that ran into this family and killed them. And that father survived, but there in the courtroom, he looked at that person that was under the influence that drove into his family and killed him, and he says, I forgive you. You know, the world looks at that as, what do you mean? I want 5 minutes with the guy, right? They want to take their vengeance out upon this guy. What do you mean you forgive them? It's because we've been forgiven. I read a story just back a while about this young boy and his mother living in Columbia. David, 11-year-old. His mother, a street vendor. They was out on the street one day. She was just trying to sell things to provide for her son. And this man walked up to her for no reason at all and shot her to death. For no reason. But yet we see it every day on the news, right? Shot her to death. Shot her multiple times. And David, being an 11-year-old boy, he was absolutely devastated. That's all he had was his mother. He had no siblings. He had no father. All he had was his mother, and a stranger walks up and shoots her to death. 11-year-old, and he couldn't handle it. And when he became a teenager, because of his grudges and because of his hatred for that assassin, it led him down a dangerous path of drugs and alcohol and a life of crime. As I was reading this story, he had gathered up a lot of guns, a lot of ammo. Of a nighttime, he says, I would lay awake dreaming of the day that I could meet my mother's killer and by what means I would kill him. Not only was David's mother shot to death, but look what it did to the young boy. Put him right into prison. Prison of his own making. Not knowing how to cope with it, he was consumed with grudges and hatred and bitterness and just dreaming of the day that he could get back at this guy. Some time passed, and the image of this assassin was tattooed in young David's mind. He never forgot who he looked like. He never wanted to forget who he looked like. And one day, he saw a man in a park sitting on a bench. And he walked right over with the intentions to blow his brains out. And he sat right down beside him. And he said, why did you kill my mother? And that guy looked at him, dropped his head, started sobbing, uncontrollable. And as bad as David wanted to kill him, he couldn't. For some reason, he couldn't. But during this time, David had a friend that was compelling him to go to church with him. And he kept saying, no, I don't want to go to church. I don't belong in church. And his friend kept on. He kept on compelling him until one day, David went to church and he heard about God's grace. God's forgiveness. And he experienced it for the first time in his life. And all of a sudden, his fist was gone. His grudges, his hatred, his bitterness for his mom's killer was gone. And David's friend had just found out recently who the killer was. And he was talking to David. And he says, I'm so glad that you didn't kill that man at the park bench because he was not the killer. Probably he had killed. The reason he was weeping over it. He says, the killer is my brother. His best friend's brother was the one that killed his mother for absolutely no reason. But because David had experienced God's grace and forgiveness, he was able to let it go. And the Lord called him into the ministry of working with street teens that comes from the pretty much the same background, dealing with drugs and alcohol and devastation in their lives. But you know what? I've talked to a lot of Christian people, and you know, I don't judge nobody. God knows my heart. You know, I'm too busy judging myself. But yet I'll talk to people and they'll tell me of things that's happened to them 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago. And I think within my heart, they've never been able to let go of that. They want to persuade themselves in thinking that I've forgiven, but they've not been able to let go because they continue to bring up the past. And listen, I'm convinced that every single one of us has a past of people that is badly wounded and hurt you. But the last thing you can do is to resurrect the past. I want to let the past be the past. Okay? I just want to let it be the past. Paul said in Philippians 3:13, this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before. And for those that keeps resurrecting the past of how people has done you and treated you, have you really and truly let go? When we fail to forgive, we truly become the victim.
Yes.
We don't really realize what kind of toll it takes on us. And you know what, friends? That is one heavy burden.
Yes.
And God does not want you to go around packing that heavy burden. You know one thing that Jesus does for us when he forgives us? He forgets it.
Amen. Thank you,
right? He promised us in his word that when he forgives you of your sins, he will never bring it back up. If we're going to be Christ-like, guess what we're going to have to do? We're going to have to forgive and to forget.
Amen.
And we're going to need God to intervene to help us.
Yes.
And you say, well, preacher, if you only knew how bad I've been hurt, I might not know how bad you've been hurt, but I know how bad one man was hurt.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
It humbles me every time I think about it. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Jesus bore the stripes. Jesus was mistreated. He was betrayed. He was hurt. He was wounded. And he died upon the cross, forgiving us. Dying that we all could be forgiven and set free from the penalty of sin. No, friends, I don't know how bad that people has hurt you, but I do know how bad God was hurt. And how God was betrayed. And how he laid down his life. That we could be saved. That we could be set free.
Amen.
Patty Davis said this about her father, Ronald Reagan, in 1981. When there was an attempt made upon his life when he was shot. Ronald Reagan told his daughter, Patty, he says, Patty, one of the reasons why I've healed up so quickly is because of my willingness to forgive him. And Patty said, my father made such an impression upon me and showed me what it truly means to forgive somebody. Did you know that it's a medical proven fact that if you have unforgiveness and grudges and bitterness in your heart, that you're going to have high blood pressure? That you're going to have stomach ulcers, that you're going to have all kinds of health issues. You know what happens to the child of God when we get to the point that we just can't forgive and release it? It affects us in so many ways. Maybe. Most of all, it affects us spiritually speaking. It affects our relationship and our communion with God. It affects our prayer life. Because you know what? You know what unforgiveness is? It's a sin. It's a grievous sin. When we come to that place in our life, we are rebelling against God. Yes. It affects you. It affects you spiritually. It affects you physically. It'll affect you mentally. It'll affect you in so many different ways. Do you know there's people that will lay awake of a night trying to figure out a way where they could get even with those that has done them wrong? Isn't life too short? Isn't life short enough? Yeah. I want to live that abundant life that Jesus promised us. And we can live that life. And you can always tell, and this isn't judging, but you can always tell with people when they have unforgiveness in their heart. You know what that causes them to be like? It causes them to be like bitter people. They have so much bitterness in their lives because they've never been able to forgive and to set it free. Listen, there might be somebody here this morning. There might be somebody watching us by the way of Facebook. You say, "Preacher, you don't know me," but that's exactly how I am this morning. I'm having so much trouble in forgiving this person because they have done this time after time after time. Again, Jesus was teaching to Peter and the disciples through this parable that you are to have an unlimited forgiveness. And my very best efforts in living right before God, I still seek Him every night for forgiveness. There's a sin of omission, there's a sin of commission. If I'm seeking my Lord to forgive me in order that I might have a good and a right relationship with Him, that my prayer lives might not be hindered, then He's expecting me to show the same forgiveness. Amen. And I want to do that. And if this is you this morning, all you got to do is say, "God, forgive me. Forgive me. Help me to forgive this person and to release it. Because I don't want to carry this burden around any longer." Again, one of my favorite scriptures is 1 John 1:9. "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." I want to thank you so much for tuning in this morning and watching us by the way of Facebook and YouTube. And if we can ever pray for you, just send us a private message. And I promise you, I will lift you up in prayer. But if you're not saved this morning, I want you to get saved. I want you to take advantage of it because Jesus is coming back. Surrender your heart and life unto the Lord. Ask Him to forgive you. Invite Him into your heart and life, okay? I want you to do that. Listen, until next time, I want you to go in the love and the peace of God. Thank you so much. Until next Sunday.